So hi guys, my name is Mansi Anand and I welcome you to this series called RBI 24/7. So guys, as you all must be knowing that in this series called RBI 24/7, we try to discuss some current affairs related to finance and economics that can be of use to you if you are preparing for competitive exams. So before moving ahead with the session, a little introduction about your mentor. So guys, I have done my graduation from Shri Guru Gobind Singh College of Commerce, and after that I have done my post graduation from Delhi School of Economics, and I am a JRF holder in Commerce as well as Management, right? So that was a brief introduction, and before we move ahead to question number 1, I would like to ask you guys to do the customary thing. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. So if you are new here and you're watching our video for the very first time, then you can press this button of subscribe to get associated with us. And after that, don't forget to press this bell icon which is flashing on the screen. It can help you to stay in touch with us and get updated regarding every notification about every video that comes up, right? And after that, you can also join our Telegram group. On this group, you can post all your doubts and queries and we'll try to get back to you as soon as possible. So time for question number 1. Here is your question number 1. Let's see who answers this correctly. So this question says, dash is a measure to assess a bank's liquidity, whereas dash is a measure of risk that lending institutions calculate before extending a mortgage. So if you want to attempt this question, you must know the meaning to the word mortgage. This has been discussed in one of the previous sessions, right? So I hope most of us are familiar with the meaning of mortgage. Moving ahead to the solution for this question, and the solution says that the correct answer is option C. So option C, it means loan to deposit ratio and loan to value ratio. So here we have two ratios. The first is called LDR, or loan to deposit ratio. So guys, try to understand it by its name. So it's a ratio which divides loans to deposits. So we are calculating it for a bank, and a bank collects deposits from its clients and extends loans to borrowers. So the number of loans it makes, when you divide it by the number of deposits it is having, then you get LDR, that is the loan to deposit ratio. So in simple terms, this ratio is telling you that whatever money the bank is collecting, what proportion is that bank extending as loans, right? So this is LDR. This is also called credit deposit ratio. So why credit deposit? Because just substituting credit in the place of loan. So credit deposit ratio. So you must read in a recent Mint article, this credit deposit ratio was discussed. So it is nothing but the loan deposit ratio. After that, coming to the LTV ratio or loan to value ratio. So for understanding this, let's take an example. Let's say I want to buy a new car. Let's say I want to buy a Maruti Sias, right? So it is costing me rupees 10 lakh. Now since I do not have 10 lakh rupees, I need to borrow from the bank and I need to get a loan. Now the bank is telling me that we can give you a loan of at max rupees 8 lakh, rest 2 lakh you would have to pay as down payment, right? So this 8 lakh rupees is the loan. So when this loan amount, so guys, in this LTV ratio, L is loan. So it is calculated by dividing loan amount to the value of asset that we are buying. So the loan amount is 8 lakh because I am taking 8 lakhs from the bank, and the total cost of the asset or the total value of the asset, that is the Maruti Sias that I am buying, is rupees 10 lakh, which gives me 0.8, right? So that means 80% of my loan, 80% of my car is financed. So that is the LTV ratio that a lending institution calculates before extending a mortgage, whereas LDR ratio tells us about the liquidity status of the bank, that how much money is it holding with itself and how much money is it extending forward, right? So I hope you are clear regarding these two ratios. Moving ahead. Okay, so the loan to deposit ratio used to assess a bank's liquidity, as I just told you. So they see, whatever the bank collects as deposit, it cannot extend a 100% loan. Let's say if a bank is having ₹1,000 crore as deposit, so it cannot lend the entire amount as loan. Why is it so? Because obviously it has some statutory requirements. It has to invest some money into liquid assets defined by SLR, and that is the statutory liquidity ratio. It has to put some money with RBI, that is the cash reserve ratio, right? So it cannot lend the entire amount, but it can lend a proportion of it, right? So typically the ideal loan to deposit ratio is 80 to 90%, right? So if a bank is having ₹1,000 crore, so it might lend something between 800 crores to 900 crores, right? So that is an ideal ratio. But since we are suffering from pandemic currently, this ratio has declined. As you can see, this credit deposit ratio or the loan deposit ratio has been falling since March end, when coronavirus spread started. As on 11 September, it was 71.8%. So the typical ideal ratio is 80 to 90%, but it was around 71.8. So you can see the low lending activity in the economy, whereas lending is very important to stimulate an economy which is suffering from recession, right? So the total amount of loans disbursed by banks shrunk by 1.4%, which means banks made no new loans, right? And discussing about this loan to deposit ratio or the credit deposit ratio, if it's too high, it means that the bank is keeping nothing with itself as a safe side or as a provision, or it is lending too much. So then it can be very risky for the bank. So bank may not have enough liquidity in that situation. But if it is too low, as in this case, that means bank is not lending enough to stimulate the economy, or it is wasting the funds that are lying with it, right? So the funds are not being optimally utilized. So moving ahead to question number two. So here is your question number two for today, which says, which of the following statements tell you about the new rule SEBI has come up with regarding the issuance of 81 bonds. So I hope we all know what are 81 bonds. So SEBI has come up with a new rule. Moving ahead to the next question. Sorry, moving ahead to the solution. Here you can see the solution is option A. Option A means that SEBI has now told the banks which are issuing 81 bonds that they can sell it only to QIBs. What are QIBs? Qualified institutional buyers. So I hope you are clear with the meaning of this word. If discussing briefly, QIBs means huge size investors or the large size investors like mutual funds, insurance companies, who have the expertise. See, there is a major difference if I invest into a company as a retail investor or as a small investor, but if on the other hand a big mutual fund invests into a company, that is going to make a huge difference to the company. My investment might not make a huge difference, right? So these huge investors are known as qualified institutional buyers. So they are basically institutional buyers like mutual funds and insurance companies. So now SEBI is saying to banks that if you want to issue any 81 bonds, any additional tier 1 bonds, so we have discussed a lot about 81 bonds when they were in news due to the case of which bank? I hope you all know it. Yes Bank. So the people who were holding 81 bonds of Yes Bank, they were totally written down, or their value just vanished. The investors, they got nothing out of it, right? So any bank who wants to issue 81 bonds will have to issue it only to QIBs, not retail investors. So why do you think SEBI has come up with such a rule? So guys, we know the rule, but it is very important to know the logic behind that, that why that particular regulator has taken such a step. So SEBI is doing this as to protect the retail investors. As I just told you, in case of Yes Bank, many people who were having their retirement savings invested into 81 bonds of Yes Bank, they got nothing in return, right? So many people suffered. But since that is the rule, or that is the risk associated with 81 bonds, here RBI can do nothing for those investors. So they want to, SEBI can do nothing for those investors. That is why they want to prevent any such situation from happening again. And they are saying that no 81 bonds for the retail investors. So that if anything bad happens and these bondholders, they have to lose the value, they are the qualified investors or the qualified institutional buyers who have the power, who have the back support to bear such a loss. Right? Moving ahead. Here you can see. So the transaction should take place over an electronic platform. So issuance of 81 bonds to QIBs, that should be on an electronic platform with a minimum allotment trading lot size at 1 crore. See, they have set the minimum at 1 crore, that if you want to buy, you will have to do a trading of this much amount. So this automatically excludes the retail investors. So 81 bonds, we all know what they are. If you don't know, you can ask for its link in the comments. They have been discussed in much detail in earlier sessions. So SEBI's latest move aims to protect retail investors. It comes after the debacle at Yes Bank. Right? Moving ahead to the third question. Here is the third question for today. I hope the screen is perfectly visible. So this question, guys, it gives you a situation. Out of the following situations, select the one or ones where buyback of shares can be an appropriate move. Okay, this question talks about buyback of shares. Now you have to tell in which of the following situations buyback can be appropriate. Moving to the solution. The solution says that the correct option is E. E means statement 2 and 3. Situation 2 and 3 are the situations where buyback can be an appropriate move for the companies. So let us first understand that what is meant by buying back of a company's own share. So it's very simple, as you can guess from its name. If a company buys its shares from the investors, then it is termed as buyback of shares. So very simple. So whenever a company wants to raise money, it issues shares and gets money in return from the investors, but it indulges into buyback whenever it wants to streamline the control, or it wants lesser people to have the control of company. In that case, when the management wants that let the company have more control over the management, or let the management have more control over the company affairs, then they go for buyback of shares. Right? As you can see, in the second situation, it says in a company called Pratham Capitals, management is worrying about some idle cash with the company. So guys, this is also one of the purpose. So let's first move to the solution, then we can come back to the situations. Here you can see three reasons why companies buy back stocks. First of all, stock buybacks can help consolidate ownership. As I told you, that if the management wants lesser investors to have control. When there is market pessimism or not a good time going on for the economy, companies use buybacks to increase the equity value. So how does equity value increase? See, since company is buying back its own shares from the market, that means there is going to be the supply of that company's shares is going to be lesser in the economy. And whenever there is lesser supply of one particular commodity, the price rises, right? So whenever the company pulls back the shares or buys back the shares, that shows this move by a company, it shows that company is believing in the potential of of the future of future growth, right? See, we say that whenever the company, the key managerial personnel or the people at the top of the company, at the top of the management of the company, they sell shares, it means they know that there is something wrong going on with the company. But if they are buying back, so that indicates they have trust in the company, or they think that the company is going to grow. That is why they want more shares, which will be valued more in the market in the future. That is why it leads to increase in equity value. After that, can make companies look financially healthy, attracting more investors. So as I just told you, it makes that it signals a trust or an optimism on the part of management, right? After that, guys, there is one more thing. So why do you think the shareholders of company would be fine with this move? Because see, since there are lesser number of shares after buyback, since there are lesser owners, the profits which the company is going to generate in future will be distributed amongst less investors, amongst less people, among less owners. That means the profit per person becomes higher. Let us try to understand this concept with a simple example. Let's say there is a pizza, right? And it has 6 pieces. So that's a pizza you and your friends have ordered. Now, if you are only 2 friends, then each one of you is going to get 3 parts of the pizza, right? But if one more friend joins you, then you become 3 people eating the pizza. That means 2 pieces for each friend. So as number of people in which the commodity has to be divided increase, the share per person falls. Same goes for the company. If there are more number of shareholders, then the profit is going to be distributed amongst more people. But when it is consolidated, when there are lesser shareholders, profit per person rises, right? So this move generally increases the EPS or earning per share of a company, right? Moving back to the situations, here you can see, first, management of Kapoor & Sons want to raise money. Obviously, if they want to raise money, they are not going to go for buyback. They will have to issue shares or securities. After that, in a company called Pratham Capitals, they have some idle cash. So they want to use it. They have some idle cash lying with them. And company shareholders are looking for an increase in earning per share. So that is why they can go for buyback. After that, Khan Constructions looking to consolidate company's ownership. So consolidate is the word here. Consolidate company's ownership. That is why they can use buyback, right? So guys, this was something about buyback. So recently, there has been a case which has been very popular, right? I'm sure you must have heard about it, that Tata and SP feud. So SP here refers to Shapoorji Pallonji Group. So, okay, long story short, if we discuss that what is happening between Tata and SP. So see, Tata, as you know, is a huge conglomerate comprising of many companies. This conglomerate was under one umbrella called Tata Sons. So you can put Tata Sons at the top. So there were 2 major owners of Tata Sons. First, Tata Trust, and the next is the SP or Shapoorji Pallonji Group, right? So Shapoorji Pallonji Group, they held about 18%. So this was going on from a long time, about 70 to 80 years, right? Now what happened when Ratan Tata, he stepped back from the management of company, he put Cyrus Mistry as the controller. So see, Cyrus Mistry belonged to the minority group SP, Shapoorji Pallonji Group. Cyrus Mistry belonged to there. So Tata stepped back, Ratan Tata stepped back, put Cyrus Mistry in control. But after few years of putting Mistry in control, Ratan Tata was not happy with his workings. Earlier he was impressed with his vision, but after seeing him work, he was not happy. So in 2016, Cyrus Mistry was asked to step down from the management. Right? After that, a conflict emerged between these two groups because Mistry belonged to the SP group. Right? So there was a conflict. There were some court cases which Mistry filed against his removal from the board. Right? So this was going on. Now, coming to the, this was the backstory. Coming to the current story, in current year, SP Group, which majorly works in the construction and real estate sector, they were facing many financial difficulties because of pandemic. So that is why they wanted to raise some money. They wanted to raise money. Obviously, they would have to put something as collateral. Now, they wanted to put the shares of Tata or the stake in Tata that they held as collateral, which was not acceptable to Tata, right? So that is why the feud began. Now, as a solution, Tata offered to buy this. So Tata told SP that, okay, you want to raise money, but we don't want any other investor to buy our shares because they don't know who is going to be buying those shares which belong to their company, right? So they offered that, let us buy those shares back. You are going to have money and we will have the major, we will have almost an entire control over the affairs of Tata, right? So here you can see this case of buyback, which is becoming very popular. But now also there are problems going on that how is Tata going to raise so much of money, because the valuation of stake of SP goes into lakhs of crores, right? So Tata is thinking to take money out of TCS, Tata Consulting Services, which is one of the major cash cows of the company, a major company under Tata which is performing very well with cash, right? So I hope now you are clear with this case and the concept of buyback. Moving ahead to the next question for today. So here is question number 4. This question says, positive pay system has been introduced by RBI to reduce dash related frauds. Very simple question. Let's say what the solution is. The solution is option D. Option D means check. So guys, RBI has recently come up with this system which is called positive pay system for check truncation system. First of all, let us understand the meaning of CTS, check truncation system. Very simple. See, whenever, let's say there are two parties, party A, party B. Party A had to make a payment to party B. So for that, gave check to party B. Now party B is going to deposit that check into B's bank, and B's bank is going to collaborate with A's bank or communicate with A's bank to provide the money from A's account in A's bank to B's account in B's bank, right? So this is a normal transaction that goes on in businesses. Now, what is CTS? CTS is that bank B, that the check which has been deposited or presented at bank B would not have to be physically transferred anywhere, but only the details or check in an electronic form can be transferred, so that money can be transferred from bank account, from A's bank to B's bank. So no physical movement of check. That is what is check truncation system. Electronically moving check, not physically moving check. Right? Under this, now RBI has come up with another system called positive pay system. So this is a very simple mechanism. They are saying, if one party gives checks to another party, right, in that case, the party which has given the check will have to provide some details to the other bank so that they can cross check or verify that that the correct party is to be receiving the payment. As you can see, drawee bank will confirm the details regarding the check, like date, name of the beneficiary,
pay amount, etc. So many details that the Droy Bank wants. So Droy means Ace Bank here, right? So Ace Bank is going to confirm details so that the party to which they are transferring the money, that goes to the correct party. So NPCI is going to develop this facility, and while availing this facility is at the discretion of account holder. If the account holder wants, they can use this facility. If they don't want, that is fine. But banks, RBI wants that banks should consider it making compulsory for payments above 5 lakhs so that no huge amount is transferred without any security check. Right, so that is the positive pay system for check truncation system. I hope you are clear with both concepts. Moving ahead to the last question for today. Here is the last question for today, which says dash in the field of economics refers to an event in the economy that persists into the future even after the factors that led to that event have been removed. So it just talks about a concept of economics which has been very popular lately. It's very common to see this in newspapers. Moving ahead to the solution, and the solution says that the correct option is option B. Option B means hysteresis. See, whenever there is a big event in the economy which is going to impact it, when it goes away or when it fades away, there are going to be some effects of it in the future. That is known as hysteresis. Let us try to understand this with the help of an example. So consider the current situation when we are dealing with a pandemic, right? Now, due to this pandemic, people faced unemployment. Now see, what we normally think is then when growth will be back, employment will begin to rise. Because companies will hire new people, new staff for their operations, and which will give rise to employment, right? So this is the normal thing that we think. But hysteresis say that once an economy has been struck with such a major event like a pandemic, like coronavirus, then in that case, people are going to remember that impact, right? So companies are not going to hire staff that whenever growth starts so easily, right? So let's say growth starts. Now we have been seeing news in newspapers that in September there has been some activity, business activity has improved. But see, there is some possibility of growth, but employment is not going to rise that easily, because see, this concept says that people have memory, and when they go through a traumatic event like pandemic, they adapt to it. That is why they do not behave as they used to do earlier. That is why companies are going to be cautious, or they are not going to hire very easily, right? So this is hysteresis. Moving ahead, here you can see some more information. So, a term coined by Sir James Alfred Ewing, Scottish physicist and engineer, refers to systems, organisms and fields that have memory. And due to that memory of that bad event or that big event, they do not perform as they used to do earlier. That is why, see, consider yourself as a person who suffers from pandemic. So let's say you are having your job, you are getting your salary, but are you spending that much as you used to do before the pandemic? So that is the reason, because we go through this event, we adapt to a certain lifestyle of spending less or saving more, because we know that because this type of event can happen again, which can affect our financial stability, right? So that is why people, even who have money right now, they're not going to spend it that easily, right? Consequences of an input are experienced with a certain time lag or delay. Example of hysteresis, delayed effects of unemployment, where unemployment continues to rise even after economy has started the recovery, right? So hysteresis can indicate a permanent change in workforce, because the attitude or behavior of people change. Workers less employable even after a recession has ended. So what is the major out of it, or how can we combat this effect of hysteresis, we can do it, actually governments can do it by coming forward with fiscal stimulus or spending or basically establishing trust in the minds of people so that they can spend with confidence, so that they do not have to worry about their financial difficulties that they have recently faced, right? So establishing trust is one major factor in combating hysteresis effect, right? So guys, these were the five questions for today. I hope you learned something new from this video. If you did, then don't forget to give us a thumbs up. I'll be back in the next session with some new information. And before we end the session, here is a question for you. You must be reading that RBI has removed some banks from its scheduled list, right? So you have to tell the reason that why has RBI removed certain banks from its list, right? So I'll be waiting for your comments. And till then, take care of yourself. Keep your studies going on. And thank you for being here. I'll see you in the next session.